for us. And today we're going to talk to a pilot who is a friend and a colleague as well, actually. She works for Cross Country in Espanol. Joana de Grigoli started flying 20 years ago. She wanted to fly when she was 12, and she has made a career and a life out of it. And she's now a competition pilot and a long-distance XC pilot. She's moved from Venezuela to Annecy in France. She flies for Jin, and she does all sorts of things. So hello, hola, Joana. Joana, are you there? Oh. Hello, Joana, there you are.
Hi, Ed, and hi, everybody.
How are you doing? Where are you just now?
I'm at home in Annecy. It's a beautiful day. It's a 250K day, high cloud base, light winds. And yeah, I'm just enjoying the sky from down here. Try not to look out the window, but well, it's a beautiful day to at least enjoy the bird singing and the flowers and spring. And it's pretty warm. I'm wearing shorts and flip-flops. Pretty warm.
Cool. So spring has properly sprung, and I keep hearing that it's an amazing spring, light wind, high cloud base, but nobody's flying, right, in France?
Nope, we're not allowed to fly here. Actually, if you fly and the police has followed some pilots and they have waited for them on the landing field and given them fines, you get 150 euro fine. So yeah, it's pretty strict. And like so far here in the area in Annecy, I haven't seen a single glider in the air. So people are respecting the confinement. But yeah, we're really hoping for it to be over because it's been an amazing week. Last week it was a little bit windier, but this week it's really beautiful. And it's high cloud base, light winds. Like you said, today looks really strong, really beautiful. Clouds are just amazing, like on the books. So yeah, I'm suffering, and I'm sure I'm not the only one. But the mountains are going to be there still, and we'll be back in the air someday.
Yeah, in May. That's what the people are thinking, aren't they? Okay, so we got 15 minutes to chat. That's what this is all about, sort of afternoon tea break time. And what I wanted to talk to you about really was XC and also competitions, because you're just back from the Pan Americans. Congratulations. You were on the podium there.
Thanks.
And I know you write about that in the next or the latest issue of Cross Country magazine. And I was interested to read that you said it was the best Pan Americans so far. Can you tell us a bit about the Pan Americans, how long they've been going, the history?
Well, they've been going on, and this was the fourth edition of the Pan Americans. The first one was in Castelo in Brazil in 2008. And there weren't that many people. There were maybe 60 to 80 pilots, I think. And then we didn't have another one until 2014, I think, which was a flop. It was in Argentina, in Tucumán, and unfortunately, there were only 28 pilots. It was really, really sad. Then there was another one a couple of years ago in Baixo Guandu, and it was pretty, pretty nice. I wasn't able to make it. But this one, it was really cool because there were 105 people, pilots, for the first time the female category was valid, because the other times there were some women, but you need a minimum of 5 women from, I think, 3 or 4 different countries. I don't remember the exact rule. And this is the first time it was valid. So I was pretty happy to be there and to make it to the podium. And the organization was great. The weather turned out to be really nice. It didn't look encouraging from the forecast when we arrived, but then it just kept getting better and we had a lot of fun. The tasks were really nice. They were very well set. And just, I don't know, the atmosphere, it was different. It was like the gang from the Americas is just different. It was really relaxed and light, and just the fact that most people spoke Spanish was very weird in a competition, because when you usually go to World Championships or PWC, most people, they communicate in English. And in this competition, the most widely spoken language was Spanish and, of course, Portuguese. So it was a lot of fun. I'm happy I was able to make it.
And where were pilots from? They come from all over the Americas, from the USA, from South America, Central America?
Yeah, there were people from Canada, the US, Mexico, Venezuela, Colombia, Brazil, Argentina, Chile, Peru, Ecuador. Where else? Okay. I think that was pretty much it. There were some people from Europe, from Russia, Spain, Italy, and there was a pilot from Japan. We had a few guests.
Now, you learned to fly in Venezuela in 2000. What was that like?
Yeah, I did learn to fly in Venezuela. I learned a little in a tiny little town in the mountains. It's a German town, and it was just fun to learn there. It's a really safe place with a huge takeoff, but a tiny little landing field. So if you learn to land there, you can land anywhere in the world. And right. It's actually going to be 20 years on the 1st of May when I finished my course. And yeah, there were only four of us in the course, and I'm the only one who still flies.
Really? And when did you, well, I know when you left Venezuela, what, like 4 or 5 years ago now?
4 years ago, 2016.
Yeah. Have you been back since?
No, unfortunately, I haven't been able to. I wanted to a couple of years ago after the super final in Colombia. I was planning to, but at the moment the borders got shut down. There were a lot of protests, so I had to cancel my trip.
Okay. So you fly long distance as well. Is it the women's South American record holder?
Yeah. Exactly.
Or what? How far did you fly in Quixada?
400 kilometers and 43 meters. 400 kilometers.
400K. It's a long, long way. And I guess one of the questions there is, what makes a good cross-country pilot and what makes a good competition pilot? What are the differences?
Well, I think... Well, I can tell you the similarities. I think for both, you should be patient and you should be fast as well. I know it sounds weird, but you have to be patient, be patient, because sometimes the day can switch off and you have to adapt to the pace of the day. So yeah, you should be patient, fast, and you should be able to adapt. In competition, for example, you need to adapt to what happens in the day. For example, because you had this route that you were given, and the arrow says you should go there, and you had already made your plan, but then the reality is different. So you have to be able to change plans. Although today, I think what you really need to do is to stick with the gaggle. Don't ever leave the gaggle and just push with them. It's something that maybe I'm a little bit tired of, because I like making my own decisions, and that's why I love flying cross country so much. I like to be able to decide where to go and adapt to what the day is telling me. Whereas in a comp, you need to, it's like being stubborn, the whole task. The day is telling you sometimes, hey, it's windy, no, don't go there, go here. And you still have to go where they tell you. And yeah, it's not for everybody, but that also makes you push a little bit more, and that makes you progress as a pilot and get better. So yeah, you need to stick with the gaggle today, and that's something I had to remind myself of at the Pan Americans. Just stick with the gaggle. Don't think too much. Okay. Of course, if you're able to lead the gaggle, yeah, you're able to think a little bit, so you can push them where you want them to go. Or you want you to go. So, and if they follow you, even better. So yeah, I think that's something you should have as a pilot.
And you're now in. I guess how do you get to that level? We often talk about pilots progressing, and pilots actually get stuck. They sort of plateau. You have flown for your national team lots of times. You've flown at the World Championships, you've flown at the Pan Americans, you've stood on lots of national podiums. And it's taken 20 years of flying and 10 years of competition, serious competition flying, I guess.
Yeah.
How do you push through and progress and keep going and learn those skills of tenacity and stubbornness, but also all the flying skills?
Well, to be honest, I think I finally figured competitions out at the super final in January 2018.
Okay.
That's what I, because I used to be really stubborn in competitions and I would go my own way and say, I want to go there where everybody else is going somewhere else. And in that competition, I really learned that you need to stick together and just push and stick together and be high and push the whole way. So yeah, it took me a long time to figure it out. I think for some people, they figure it out earlier, and that's good because they invest less time and money. So yeah, sometimes you get stuck, and there were some points where I thought I got stuck because I was always, you know, behind and not making any podiums or anything. And it was at that comp, at that super final, that I kind of like switched and learned that, like, okay, this is what you need to do. Of course, I've always had a disadvantage because of the glider, because I fly an extra small, and for many years I didn't have a competitive glider or a fly with a D glider. I've had everything. So when you finally have a glider, you're competitive. You can stick with the gaggle and stay with them. So, but for example, it was last year after the World Championships that I realized that I needed to take a break from competitions and go back to what I love the most, which is cross-country flying. Of course, I still love competitions. I love the vibe, the people, and, you know, flying together and all the stuff before flying, after flying, all the things that happen in a competition. But I think I'm stepping back a little bit, so I get to miss it a little bit and then maybe come back. I think it's important to make a break. And so, yeah, you miss a little bit because I've been doing it for too long. I've been competing nonstop for 18 years, actually. Mm. And yeah, it's been a lot. So for some people, they get to that point where they get stuck after maybe a couple of years, and some people never get stuck. I think it depends on how you progress and what takes you there. So,
you moved to Annecy a few years ago. What have you enjoyed about learning to fly in the mountains around Annecy in the Alps?
When I moved here, I felt like I didn't know how to fly because flying in the Alps is very different. So I had to relearn how to fly. And
in what way?
Well,
things did you have to relearn?
For example, here in the Alps, you play a lot with where the sun is, and not so much with the wind. In Venezuela, we play a little bit more with the wind because it's, you know, sometimes conditions are just booming. You just go up anywhere. So you just have to be careful where the wind comes from so you don't end up in the lee or something. Whereas here, people, you need to go in on the lee. You need to protect yourself from the wind and just look for that sunny phase. So that's something I had to learn. And at the beginning, it was kind of like shocking. But then I learned, also learning in the morning, flying in the morning, sorry, it was new to me because I always waited for it to be good to launch. Whereas here, as soon as you feel a little thermal come in, you go, and you have to fly in conditions that maybe you're not comfortable with because thermals are just starting to pop and sometimes it's not very pleasant. But then you get used to it and then you warm up, and as soon as day goes booming, you're already warmed up and in the air. Something I love about here is that I can do many activities. I can fly and I can fly cross country. I can train SIV, and there's Annecy is very nice for that because you can fly all year long. It has a very nice microclimate. So I've actually flown more hours per year here in Annecy since I've moved to Europe than in Venezuela the years before. because people flew mostly on the weekends, so I had to wait for people to fly on the weekends, and we were very limited in terms of cross-country flying because of safety issues. Mm-hmm. So I would only fly maybe, I don't know, a couple hours a week, and that's it. Whereas here, I've gotten so many flying hours that it's amazing. I keep a log. I'm organized in that, and always I've kept a log for as long as I've had a GPS, and I've seen my hours, and it's amazing. For example, the last 4 years, I've logged, 3 years, I've logged 200 hours every year, more or less. Wow. And in Venezuela, I would log like 120, 150. And so that's interesting. So,
and Annecy is a busy place. Have you got any secret spots in Annecy?
Well, I have a secret spot that is called La Sandrie.
Okay.
It's a nice spot south of the lake, and it's a nice place to go XC flying because you're right there on the RV range, so you can go north on the RV or south to the Bosch, which is like the XC highway here in the area, and you can also go to NC or whatever. Also, for beginners, it's really nice because there's a top to bottom that is really long. It's very spectacular because you have the mountains, the lake, and it's the height difference is very high, so it's a really nice top to bottom, and you have a lift, you have a restaurant, and the landing field is nice and grassy and big. So I think it's a place where people can have fun regardless of their level, and it's not so crowded, because sometimes plein fait can be really crowded and stressful. So it's a place where I like to go when I need some peace.
What's it called? La Sandrie?
La Sandrie, yeah.
La Sandrie. Okay. We'll put a link in the bottom in the comments so people can see. Cool. Okay, Jojo, that is 17 minutes. We're over our allotted 15-minute tea break time. So listen, thank you very much for joining us.
Well, thanks for having me. It was fun.
And, I hope to see you soon. I hope to see you back in the air. Hopefully we get to fly before the amazing conditions turn off or it starts raining.
We will.
Alrighty. Thank you very much.
Okay, you're welcome. Thank you.
Bye. Bye-bye.